Chapter 12 gets into ring theory, which, yeah, I can't help but think of Lord of the Rings when I think of ring theory. Or, yes, rings on your finger. But it has nothing to do with Lord of the Rings, and it has nothing to do with rings on your finger. It's just a name that somebody picked, and we're stuck with it. But it kind of makes me happy that we can use ordinary words like groups and rings and fields, we'll also talk about. And they refer to things that most people don't know about. It's our sort of secret lingo. What is a ring? A ring is, first of all, a non-empty set that's got two binary operations defined on it instead of one, as in group theory. So it seems like we're upping the level of difficulty by adding a binary operation. In some ways, yes, we are, but in some ways, it makes it not necessarily more difficult. So a ring R is a non-empty set with two binary operations. What should we call them? Oh, how about plus and times, addition and multiplication? Why not? Right? That's what we're used to. So it's not an empty set, is what I'm saying here. It's a non-empty set with two binary operations. Remember, just like with groups, our textbook has the convention that if I use the words binary operation, it's assumed to be closed. Some textbooks don't make that assumption. Binary operation for some textbooks just means take two elements, combine them to get another element that's not necessarily in the same set. You're combining two elements to get a single element. That's a binary operation. But our author says, hey, let's just go ahead and assume binary operations are closed. This implies closure for us. So given two elements in R, A and B, A plus B would be an R, and A times B would be an R, i.e. A and B are an R. That implies, yes, A plus B is an R, and A times B is an R. But we want more than closure, just like we want with groups. With respect to the addition, rings are Abelian groups with respect to addition. I'm not really writing this as a formal definition here. I'm writing it kind of informally. R is an Abelian group with respect to the binary operation of addition. What would that mean? I.e., one thing it would mean is that, well, you've got associativity. A plus B plus C with the A plus B in parentheses is the same as A plus B plus C with the B plus C in parentheses. The order doesn't matter. You can add A and B first and then add C, or you can add B and C first and then add A. There's an identity with respect to addition. When our operation is addition, even in group theory, the identity was denoted by zero, not E. There exists a zero in R such that A plus zero equals zero plus A equals A. Maybe I should have emphasized the commutativity before that. There's also the commutative property, A plus B equals B plus A. And for all elements A of R, there exists inverses, additive inverses in this case. So I'd want to use negative A for the additive inverse, such that when you add A and negative A in either order, you get the identity, which is zero. What about multiplication? Is R a group or an Abelian group with respect to multiplication? No. In fact, R is never, I do mean never, a group with respect to multiplication. Now it gets tricky. Sometimes its non-zero elements are a group under multiplication. But even in not those cases, the entire ring R is not a group under multiplication. In particular, zero, which exists, it's the additive identity, never has a multiplicative inverse. Catch that? It's very important. Rings are never groups under multiplication, though sometimes their non-zero elements are groups under multiplication, but not always. In the definition of a ring, we don't make that assumption. With respect to multiplication, this is a very informal thing here that I'm doing again, not a formal definition. The formal definition is in the book. What properties do we want to hold? I hope it makes some sense. You'd at least want associativity to hold. AB times C with AB having parentheses around it is the same as A times BC with the B times C having parentheses around it. That should seem like a minimal kind of thing you would want to be true. And it is. Does there exist a one? An E, so to speak? Should we call it one, maybe? A multiplicative identity? Not necessarily. And we also don't assume there are multiplicative inverses. And in fact, if there's no multiplicative identity, then there can't be multiplicative inverses. So do we stop with associativity? No. There is one more property we write down. It's a property that you know from high school and maybe even earlier, but we haven't really used it in this class. It starts with a D, D-I, D-I-S. I love doing this. D-I-S-T, distributive property. There we go. There's a distributive property that describes how multiplication and addition interact. By the way, I'm not writing the dots there for multiplication. I could, but as usual, we usually don't bother. A times in parentheses B plus C, meaning add B and C first and then multiply by A, can be done by multiplications that are done first before the adding, like that. The commutative property doesn't necessarily hold. So I also have to write down another distributive property where the A is on the other side. And technically speaking, since commutativity of multiplication does not necessarily hold, it is a separate property. Yes, commutativity does not necessarily hold. AB in general, AB does not equal BA. Why do we not want to allow commutativity of multiplication? Doesn't that seem like a reasonable thing to do? Well, kind of for the same reason we don't allow with in the definition of a group, is because there are nice examples of groups, interesting examples, you might say, worthy of study, that are not abelian, not commutative. Likewise, with rings, there are interesting, important examples where you've got a multiplication that's not commutative, and so we want to still allow those to be rings. It makes for a richer field of study, you might say, by not making this part of the definition of a ring. In particular, if your ring elements are, for example, matrices, we know matrix multiplication is not commutative, but we would like to allow certain sets of matrices to be rings, with the operations being matrix addition and matrix multiplication. If AB does equal BA, then R is called what? An abelian ring? No. a, well, commutative ring. Don't call it an Abelian ring. Why not? I mean, well, we could, but it's traditional not to. Why? Group theory and ring theory actually developed separately. Group theory developed in its rudimentary form in the early 1800s by people like Abel for Abelian and Galois, and became more formalized in the later 1800s. I don't remember offhand when the official definition of a group was made. I'm guessing late 1800s. Ring theory developed separately, I think later than group theory, if memory serves me correct, maybe in the mid 1800s, by people who were interested in different things than the group theorists were. The group theorists initially were interested in solving algebraic equations. For example, understanding why quintics, fifth degree polynomials, cannot be solved by radicals. There's no formula or algorithm to solve those equations using what, you know, roots, essentially. Ring theorists, the rudimentary beginning ones, were more interested, I think, typically in the behavior of, well, rings of matrices, rings of polynomials, where you're just focused on the algebraic behavior of those things and not necessarily focused on roots. So they had two separate development paths. It was only later that people realized there was a unity that rings are Abelian groups under addition when the formal definition of a ring was created, I believe around 1900 or something, 1910 or something like that. Then they were unified to some degree. Let's end by just mentioning some examples of rings. Important examples of rings. Z is a ring, the integers, under ordinary addition and ordinary multiplication of integers. Think about it. We already know Z is an Abelian group under ordinary addition. We already know that. It also, the multiplication satisfies the associative property and the distributive property. It's a commutative ring. Multiplication is commutative. Is a commutative ring. It does have the number one in it, which is algebraically special. It is a multiplicative identity. I said in the definition of a ring that you don't have to have a multiplicative identity, but Z does. I could write with multiplicative identity one. However, I'm not going to. I'm going to write with unity one. If a ring has a multiplicative identity in ring theory, it's called a unity. It is denoted by one instead of E. I guess group theory is probably developed by the Germans because E stands for Einheit. And ring theory probably was developed, I don't know, by the French. They used one for their multiplicative identity. Not positive about what I just said there. Just guessing. They call it a unity. Yes, you could call it a multiplicative identity. It is a multiplicative identity. But the word people use is unity. If your ring consisted of matrices, though, if it was a matrix ring, this one would be the identity matrix, not the number one. 2z represents the even integers. That's the notation we use in this context for the even integers, which is, as an Abelian group, a subgroup of Z. It is also a ring. Multiply any two even integers, you're going to get an even integer, right? You're not going to get an odd one. It's closed under multiplication. It's also associated with respect to multiplication. And the distributive property still works. It is a commutative ring, but It does not have a unity without unity. There's no one in there. So that's kind of weird. You can have a commutative ring that has no one. It can get even weirder. It can get even weirder. Here's a weird example. Okay, so Z sub n, here's a general example, first of all, which is as a set, as always, 0 through n minus 1, is a commutative ring with unity 1. Under what are the operations? Addition mod n, it's an Abelian group, and multiplication mod n. However, this can get really weird, especially when n is not prime. As a particular example, consider Z6. That's a ring, a commutative ring with unity 1. Under addition mod 6 and multiplication mod 6, it's got a subring. If we have subgroups, we better have subrings. 0, 2, and 4 is a subring of Z6. And you might say, well, okay, it's a commutative ring, subring, I guess, without unity, though. But guess what? Even though there's no one in there, it does have a unity. What? 4 is the unity under multiplication. 4 times 0 is 0. 4 times 2 is 8. Mod 6 is 2. And 4 times 4 is 16. Mod 6 is 4. 4 times anything is the anything. 4 is acting as the multiplicative identity, the unity of this subring of Z6, where Z6, the unity is 1. What? But wouldn't that mean both 1 and 4 are unities up here? No. For example, 4 times 5 does not equal 5. Mod 6 equals 2. 4 is not the unity of Z6, but it is the unity of the subring. Whoa, that is so weird. Rewatch the video, re-listen to what I just said there to try to really let this sink in. Ring theory can get really weird this way. We would actually like to mostly avoid weird examples like this, but technically they are part of ring theory. There are more examples in the book. Make sure you study those.